Praise the Lord. Thank God for another opportunity to share his word. Thank God for this Wednesday night Bible study. As always, truly, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Lesson title for tonight is Down But Not Conquered. In other words, I may be down, but I'm not defeated. And so that's what I want to look at a little bit tonight. And the text is from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 15. Again, down yet not conquered. Father, we come to say thank you. Fathers, in the most precious name of your Son, Jesus, that we come this night, we come to bless you, to love you, to honor you, to lift up your holy name, to magnify your holy name, to glorify your holy name. Father, I thank you for this opportunity to share your word one more time. Lord, I pray as your word goes forth in power, might, and spirit, it will continue to heal, deliver, and set the people free. Father, I pray that your word will encourage them, Lord God, build them up, lift them up, Lord God, and allow them to know that, yes, they can be down. There will be situations, there will be moments in life, but yet not conquered. And Lord, again, it's your word that will bring the peace. It's your word that will bring the encouragement. It's your word that will bring the joy. It's your word that will speak peace. And we thank you for it in advance. Touch again, heal again, deliver. We thank you for this night. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen. Glory to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning at verse number 7, the word of God reads, it says, "But we have this treasure in earthly vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body of the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So then death is working in us, but life in you. And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believe and therefore I spoke, we also believing and therefore speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sake, that grace having spread through the many may cause thankfulness to abound to the glory of God." Praise the Lord. And here when we look at the word of God, cast down yet not conquered. You know, I thank God for his word. I thank God for how we're able to share his word so that we can be encouraged, so that we can be built up. Again, I say cast down but unconquered. You know, first of all, when we look at the scripture here, excuse me, verse number 7, it says, "But we have this treasure in earthly vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us." First of all, when you look at the text here, and the way Paul was talking about an earthly vessel, the Greek here, the earthly vessel was clay pots, and clay pots in ancient times actually was used to put treasures in, and the treasures was buried in those clay jars and buried in the ground. And so here, when we look at this earthly vessels, we're talking about the human body. We're talking about you and I. We're talking about these bodies being earthly vessels. But then it talks about we have a treasure in these earthly vessels. And so the treasure that we have in these earthly vessels is the spirit of the living God. It's God's spirit. It's God's word. You know, people have said, you've heard it said that, and you should be saying it, that that God's word is a treasure, so we should treasure the word of God. And so when we talk about this earthly vessel, this physical body, we're talking about the spirit of the living God living on the inside of every man, woman, boy, girl who has indeed recognized Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior. And so we have this treasure, praise God, in this earthly vessel. And we're going to continue to read that. It says that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. And that is realizing, or maybe I can use the word recognizing, that the power that we have on the inside is the power that's given to us through the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so we've got to recognize it. It says the excellence of the power is not of us, but it's of God. In other words, again, even when we look at the title, the theme, down, not conquered, I might be down. Things may be going on in my life. I may not know which way to turn always. I may not have everything that I think I should have. However, I might be down, but I'm not conquered. I'm not defeated to the point that I don't know which way to turn. And that's why when we get to where we are and we look at the word here, as Paul said, cast down but unconquered. And so, yes, things are going on. Yes, there's some things that may hit you hard sometimes, overwhelm you sometimes. But the scripture here is saying that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. In other words, you know, we can only do so much. We're limited, but the power of God is unlimited. In other words, nothing's too hard for God. Nothing is impossible for God. The scripture said, with God, all things are possible to them who believe. And so it's a matter of where we are in this walk of faith. Praise God. Looking at verse number 8, the scripture says, it says, we are hard pressed on every side. Every side, yet not crushed. And I was looking at how hard pressed, and hard pressed is translated afflicted, trouble on every side. And when you look at this, he say, I'm afflicted on the outside. I'm afflicted on the inside, which means inside and out. In other words, wherever I turn, I'm being afflicted. And when you look at that word afflicted, it's talking about a persistent pain or distress. In other words, if I turn to the left, it's there. If I turn to the right, it's there. In other words, he said, I'm hard pressed on every side and things are going on. And he said, but I'm hard pressed. But then when we go on and look at the word, he says, hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed, not crushed, not broken, not defeated, not oppressed. Even though things are not where I'd like for them to be, even though I'm being hard pressed, even though, as the scripture says, as you translate this word, trouble on every side, this is going on over here, that's going on over there, that's going on over there. All those things are happening. Yet what Paul was saying is that hard pressed, but I'm not crushed. I'm not crushed to the point to where I'm broken. You know, sometimes your will can be broken. Your desire to live can be broken. Your desire to just keep pushing can be broken. What Paul was saying here is that when we go back in these earthly vessels and the excellence of the power of God that's operating in these earthly vessels is why he could talk about or speak about, or I can share right now how being hard pressed, how being afflicted, how having trouble on every side, yet because of the excellence of the power of God that's operating on the inside, I am not crushed. Because of the power that's operating on the inside of you, you're not crushed. Yes, it seems like all heck has broken loose. Yes, it seems like you don't know which way to turn. As we go on and read, and you look at even how Paul continues to describe this, and I say, we are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. And to be perplexed means that you're at a loss, and you talk about, I'm not sure if I can see a way out. But what Paul says, even in the midst of this, he said, perplexed, but not in despair. And despair means just utterly lost, meaning no hope at all. And so Paul say, even though I'm perplexed, I am not in despair. I still have hope. I still have a purpose. I still know that God is able. I still know that God's word said that he would never leave me nor forsake me. And so if I continue to hold on to that, and I look at this again, perplexed, to be at a loss, can't see a way out, yet Paul was not in despair, which means utterly lost. And I made a little note here. It says, listen, as believers in Christ, you will face trials. However, you must remember that God controls the trials and uses them to strengthen his people. And so, again, that's where you got to go back and think about the treasures that's in these earthly vessels. And that treasure is the Holy Spirit, first of all. And the Holy Spirit is God's spirit. It's God's power. It's God's healing. It's God's deliverance. It's God's peace. It's God's joy. It's God's mercy. It's God's grace. See, all those things are in the inside, or I should say on the inside of every man, woman, boy, girl who has indeed recognized Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. So I can go right back and look at, again, this title, this theme, down, not conquered. Paul said, cast down, but unconquered. So in other words, even though all those things going on, I have not been conquered by the enemy. Yes, there's the fiery darts that's coming, and they're coming constantly. Praise God, hitting here, hitting there. Okay, we talked about hard press on every side. Everywhere you turn, there's something going on. Perplexed. However, Paul said, but not in despair. And so again, when we look at this, we look at God's power, we look at his glory that's manifested through his people, so that we're able to endure hardship, so that we're able to endure the different things that's going on. And so the earthly vessels that have the treasure, the excellence of the power of God, is what we need to continue to rely on. We must recognize and understand that until God's power is truly manifested in our lives, we're going to be in trouble. But once we recognize and allow the Spirit of God to truly operate, and we begin to rely on the power that's within the Word of God, those troubles, those times, that hard pressed time, being perplexed, all those different things, when those things come, praise God, yes, they may overwhelm you for a little period of time, but eventually you're going to get through those things. And that's the whole key, getting through. See, you don't want to stay there. What happens a lot of times in this walk of faith is that we stay there. We stay there because we don't push. We don't press on, praise God. To continue reading this, he says, we are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We're perplexed, but not in despair. Verse number 9 says, persecuted, but not forsaken. Now, when you look at persecution, and I again, the picture behind the word persecuted is pursuit by someone determined to harm someone else. Now, Paul knew that he was not forsaken by the Lord. But what I want you to understand, when you start thinking about persecuted and you think about how this translation here, it's a picture of somebody seeking after you, to bring some type of harm. It may be physical harm, it may be mental harm, it may be spiritual harm. And so when we look at this from our spiritual perspective, you have to look at the enemy. The enemy wants to persecute you. The enemy wants to keep you down. But we've got to understand, like Paul understood, that the scripture in Hebrews 13:5 says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Paul knew that even in the midst of the storm, even in the midst of all that he was going through, he knew in his heart of hearts that God would not leave him, even though there was the pursuit from the enemy, the pursuit from the people who was trying to bring about bodily harm, which is the physical harm, praise God, the mental harm. You understand what I'm saying? The spiritual harm. In other words, this was the spirit. This is a person. This is to bring about something to bring you down, to bring about something to overwhelm you, to bring about something to keep your focus from off the word of God, off the spirit of God, off the power of God. But you got to go and you got to be like Paul. You've got to know within your heart, no matter what's going on, no matter what you may feel like, says that I will never leave you nor forsake you. As we go on to read this, praise God, Paul says, struck down, but not destroyed. Now here, this really excites me, because Paul is giving us an opportunity to really see the power of God. And that's why you can see cast down, but unconquered. When we read here, he says, struck down, but not destroyed. You know, there was a period in Paul's life when he was in Lystra, a crowd of people, they actually stoned him and they left him for dead. Now, first of all, you have to think about when one was stoned to death, they were put in an area and people would pick up rocks. When you say stone, you know, you think of stone. But we're talking about big old giant rocks, and some would be smaller stones, but and they would just throw at a particular person until they were actually dead. You're talking about a horrible way to die. You think about down, and it, just try to imagine trying to cover up. You cover up your face, and a rock hits you upside the head. You instinctively you move your hand to that part, and just about that time, a rock hits you in the face. I mean, you're talking about, and I don't know the number of people who would have been responsible for, you know, throwing the rocks, but I've got to imagine in order to stone someone to death that it would be quite a few people. And so just thinking about that, and okay, you covered your face, and so now you got all this area balled up, and now the rock hits you and breaks a rib. It hits you. You understand what I'm saying? That just a horrible, horrible way for one to die. However, Paul was stoned, and they actually thought that he was dead. And that's why he can say here, struck down but not destroyed, because they weren't able to kill him. But I can only try to imagine, you can only try to imagine how beaten and bloody his body probably was. Be, you know, after that, because again, like I say, you got these rocks, you got these stones, you got all these things coming from different direction. And here's the key to that too. You might have somebody that throws soft and hit, but then you have that person with that intent that when that rock is delivered on you, my God, and bam. And you know, the enemy is the same way right now. And we got to just see this from a spiritual perspective. The enemy and his demons, you know, they always throwing something at us. They always trying to get us off balance. They want to hit us upside the head. And as soon as we cover the head, hit us in the face. And as soon as we cover the face. But what we've got to understand is we go back and we look at the scripture when we first started. But we have this treasure in these earthly vessels, the excellence of the power of God operating in us. And so like Paul, when the stones come, and we can just see it, it doesn't have to be a physical stone. It doesn't have to be a physical rock. Let's look at it from a spiritual perspective. It hurts when it hits. bam, you try to cover up. You may even, you know, ball up into the fetal position thinking that you could cover up, but things are hitting. Things are hitting. Just like what Paul said, glory to God, he said, hard pressed on every side, meaning afflicted with trouble, the bills, the health, the relationship, the children, the job, just so many, many, many different things going on all around. And that's why you got to begin to draw strength from God, because guess what? If you could do it, you wouldn't be going through it. If you could fix it, there's no way from a human perspective that you would continue to endure that. No way. And so that's why you've got to see, that's why you've got to understand that you don't have the power. You don't have the authority to make this thing change. But we know one who does, and that's the source that we're tapping to. And that's when we begin to pray and we begin to say, Holy Spirit, lead me, guide me. Holy Spirit, show me what it is I need to do, where it is I need to go, what it is I need to say. Because again, when we look at where Paul was, Paul says, struck down but not destroyed. Maybe you say, I'm struck down, but you know what you can say? I'm struck down. I went through this. I got through this. The doctor said this. The doctor said that, but I got through that. Yes, I was struck down. Glory to God. I had to lay down for a period of time, but I'm up. I'm up. I'm moving. And I thank God for the movement. I thank God for his grace. I thank God for his mercy. I thank God for his loving kindness. And that's why, again, I have to say it one more time. Cast down but unconquered. Come on. Down yet not conquered. You understand what I'm saying? See, the enemy is just trying to overwhelm you. The enemy is trying to overpower you. The enemy wants you to think that, again, that there's no way out. The enemy wants you to think that it's over. But we know better. And you know what? When you know better, you do better. When you know better, you think a different way. You act a different way. You travel a different way. You walk a different way. You see what I'm saying? You talk a different way because you know better. And when you know, again, as the scripture says in Hebrews 13:5, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's like saying, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's like saying, I will never, ever. I will never, never. You see what I'm saying? That's what God is saying. And he's saying that only to those that have recognized Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, because we're in a relationship. We're in the family. And being that we're in the family, we're going to be taken care of. So I go back again and I look at Paul, say, struck down but not destroyed. Stone left for dead. However, he was not killed. So look at that. His life was spared, and the reason why his life was spared so he could continue to preach the good news and testify of God's deliverance. You've not been destroyed because God wants you to continue to be that living witness, that living testimony, to talk about his deliverance, to talk about his peace, to talk about his joy, to talk about his love, to talk about God as a whole, to talk about his mercy, to talk about his grace. There's just so much after you've gone through what you've gone through, come on, that you can now share with somebody else. See, there's something that has happened in your life that you can share with somebody else. No, by any stretch of the imagination, when we begin to ask for these things, however, the mere fact that these things have happened to us and God has brought us through these things, because he did not forsake us, he did not leave us, now like Paul, and Paul's life was spared so that he could continue to preach the good news and testify of God's deliverance. You can continue to preach the good news. You don't have to be the preacher. You don't have to be the pastor. But you can share the good news of Jesus Christ. You can say, I get joy when I think about what he's done for me. You see what I'm saying? And you can begin to share that with somebody else. You know, the scripture even tells us that we should always be ready to give a reason for why we believe, and I paraphrase, why we believe, why we act the way we do, even in the midst of a storm. while we're able to continue to get through. And we need to be able to share that with others. And I think about Paul not being killed. Yes, he says struck down, but not destroyed. Going on to verse number 10. And verse number 10 says, always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our bodies. Now, when I was looking at this, always caring about in the body of dying of the Lord Jesus, the life of Jesus also may be manifested in us. In other words, you got to look at it and you think about Jesus paid it all. Jesus gave his life for you and I. And Paul is saying that I should always be mindful of that. I should always recognize what he did for me. You should recognize what he's done for you. When we think about our relationship with Almighty God, we think about it because of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why we are who we are. That's why we're in the position that we're in. And so when I go back and I have to look at Paul, and I understand that Paul went through a lot of things, but he went through those things because God had a special calling on his life. God did not tell him that things was going to be easy. Actually, he told him that he would suffer many things for the sake of the word. And sometimes for the sake of the word, to get the word out, to share with others, to be a testimony of others, sometimes we have to go through something. The word of God here, and I say, it sees that Paul's endurance in all types of hardship, it produced eternal life, and he was able to preach the gospel. And what I want you to understand is, again, cast down but unconquered. Yes, perplexed, you understand what I'm saying, but not crushed. Again, go back and look, hard pressed on every side. However, we still reference Hebrews 13:5. I will. And who's saying I will? Jesus is saying, I will never, ever, ever leave you nor forsake you. And so when we see this, we've got to understand and recognize that what God was saying is that I am always there. I am always here. And so with that said, I got to go back and look at verse number 7 of 2 Corinthians 4:7. But you and I, we have this treasure in earthly vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. That's where I want to place the emphasis right now, that we have to recognize these earthly vessels. Remember, I talked about the earthly vessels as Paul used as a reference here. In the ancient times, they were clay pots. In the clay pots, they would put a treasure in those pots and they would bury them in the ground. We have a treasure right now that's been placed in our hearts. You see what I'm saying? And so the fact that we have the power, the word, the spirit of the living God in our hearts, that's that treasure in these earthly vessels. And so with that said, that means no matter what the particular situation, no matter what it may look like, no matter what it may feel like, you have the power that's operating on the inside. And we must, you must, I must tap into that source of power. So whenever we have things going on, whenever the enemy is trying to stone us in the spirit, and those stones are coming, praise God, sometimes they hit. And yes, it hurts sometimes. Glory to God. Paul says that he was struck down, but yet not destroyed. You've been struck down, but thank God not destroyed. And a reason that you're able to look and see and listen to this particular message is a clear indicator that you haven't been struck down. You still may be knocked down, but you haven't been struck down because you're not, I'm sorry, you haven't been destroyed. And the fact that you haven't been destroyed, it's given you another opportunity to talk about God's goodness, to talk about God's grace, to talk about God's mercy, to talk about God's loving kindness. See, we have a testimony. We have God's spirit manifested in our spirit, and that is power. That is love. That is joy. That is peace. That is such a level of confidence that no matter what we experience, we know again that God is able to bring us through. And for me, it reminds me of my favorite verse of scripture. I quote it a lot, and I actually want to read it right now. It's Ephesians 3:20. It says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think according to the power that's working in us." Now, I wrote myself a little note here. It says, "Neither God nor his power is limited by human imagination." So in other words, what we've got to understand, it says to begin to think, right, or act. So even though we can't think it, even though you may not be able to ask it, God's love or his power is not limited by these limited imaginations of ours. See, and so recognize God's power, recognize God's authority, and most of all, yield, commit, and submit to his authority. Praise God. Again, you may have been down, but not conquered. Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the encouragement that your word has given to us this day. We thank you and recognize, Lord, your word in Hebrews 13:5. You said, "I will never leave you nor forsake you." Father, we thank you for your word. And Father, we ask that the people of God would begin to read your word, study your word, Lord, and allow your word to penetrate their hearts, Lord. Let it be your word, Lord God, when those hard times come, Lord God, when hard pressed on every side, Lord, let them be able to go back and recall your word. Let them be able to speak your word, that your word might bring life. Your word might bring encouragement. Your word might bring peace. Your word might bring joy. And we thank you for that. Even now, Lord, for those that are down, Lord God, Lord, those that are sick, Lord God, Lord, we pray this day for divine healing to take place. Lord, touch them right now from the top of their heads to the very soles of their feet, every joint, every muscle, every ligament, every tissue, every blood vessel, every vein, right down to the marrows as in their joints. And for that, we want to say thank you. And Lord, for that person or persons that don't know the saving grace of Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, allow this to be the day that they ask that question, "What must I do to be saved?" Father, we thank you for this day. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. And I say, maybe you're that person that has just asked that question, "What must I do to be saved?" The scripture says that believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, praise God, that Jesus is in fact the Son of God, that he died, is buried, and now sits at the right hand of the Father. And it says that with your mouth, confession is made unto salvation. It says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And so you want to make that personal confession today. You do that by saying, "Father, I recognize that I am indeed a sinner. Father, forgive me. Father, I recognize that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. Jesus, come into my life, live in me and through me for the glory of God. Jesus, I now recognize you as my personal Lord and Savior. I today am confessing with my mouth that you are indeed Lord, and I believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead, and I am now saved. I thank you for this day. Father, thank you for receiving me into your families. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen." And I say, first of all, welcome to the family of God. Thank God. The scripture said the angels in heaven are rejoicing over your conversion right now. To God be the glory. Look, get a Bible, begin reading in St. John chapter 1. In the beginning was the word. Praise God. And so we thank God for your tuning in. We thank God. And right now, no matter where you may be, just recognize that, yes, you may be cast down, but you are unconquered. You may be down, yet not conquered. So just recognize that, yes, the fiery darts will come, but praise God, because of that shield of faith, because of your relationship with Almighty God, he's going to bring you through. Until we have opportunity to get together the next time, I ask the Lord's blessings on you and your family. May he keep you, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.